as far as Arctic goes, we have an FS that we put out last year, and that FS indicated about a $1.1 billion NPV, and we used $3 copper, $1,300 gold, about $18 silver price. If we look at that in the spot environment, it's more like $2.3 billion in terms of NPV on a 100% project basis. So more than doubled.
The Financial Survival Network. Now more than ever. The Financial Survival Network.
And welcome. You are watching and hopefully listening to the Financial Survival Network. I'm Kerry Lutz. And well, what can you say about copper? I often liken it to if that movie The Graduate was filmed recently, and Dustin Hoffman is there in the pool and he's talking to the guy wouldn't be saying plastics anymore. He'd be saying copper, and for good reason. Copper is at or near its all-time high. It's heading towards $5 a pound. And when you think of copper, you got to be thinking of our sponsor, Trilogy Metals, a truly tier one deposit in Alaska in the Ambler Mining District. There's a lot more to the company than just that, but our good friend Tony Giardini, CEO, is with us now. I know, Tony, you're excited. You've got nearly 15,000 meters of drilling for this year and a huge budget of $27 million. You're not worrying about where that money's coming from. Well capitalized. I guess I should ask you, what does the current copper price mean for TMQ's projects, and that's the ticker symbol, both on the Toronto and the New York. What does it mean for TMQ's projects in terms of NPV, net present value?
Kerry, well, first of all, thanks for having us back on your show. We really do appreciate it, and we appreciate the support as well. And I think you're absolutely right about, you know, where copper is these days. It certainly is a metal that everybody is talking about and thinking about, and for good reason, of course, because people are thinking about electric vehicles, they're thinking about infrastructure, and just other development that could tie into the electrical grid, which all needs copper. So copper is definitely going to benefit in a big way. And as you said, our project is, we have two projects in the Ambler Mining District that are identified. One is an advanced development asset called Arctic, which we'll speak more to in terms of that $27 million program. And then the second one is Bornite, which is an advanced exploration project. As far as Arctic goes, we have an FS that we put out last year, and that FS indicated about a $1.1 billion NPV, and we used $3 copper, $1,300 gold, about $18 silver price. If we look at that in the spot environment, it's more like $2.3 billion in terms of NPV on a 100% project basis. So more than doubled. And what that just highlights is the just the high grade nature of our deposit, and just how significant it is in terms of the metal production that we have, not just obviously gold or copper, but gold and other metals as well. So we're in a really good position, and we're heading into the field season very excited.
Hey, so your IRR has got to be heading up towards 50% at this point, because the project's NPV is almost doubled since last year.
Yeah, the IRR is over 40% right now on an after-tax basis, which is excellent. And, you know, the other major focus for us, and this is really going to be part of a drill campaign this year, is extending mine life at Arctic. So right now, the Arctic project, as we see it in the feasibility study, foresees a 12-year mine life. And what we're hoping to do is obviously extend that considerably. And if we can do that, it will go a long way towards ensuring that we've got lots of flexibility in terms of the operation of Arctic and further exploration potential in the district. So that's a big factor of what we're trying to do with our exploration program this year.
Hey, so on the plus side, the inflation story makes your prices go up, NPV go up, and IRR. On the downside, costs go up as well, energy particularly. Impact of that, it seems like it's a net positive when you calculate all the numbers.
Yeah, at this point, we haven't updated either the capital cost or the operating cost because the feasibility study we put out last year was put out the fall of last year. So we don't expect a major change with respect to the capital costs associated with the project. Operating costs could be impacted, but right now, because of the byproduct credits that you get from gold and from zinc and lead and silver, the actual cash costs to operate the mine are negative. So if there are impacts on costs, they won't be significant in terms of the overall NPV of the project. And we think there's opportunities to manage those effectively as a project moves forward.
And rightfully so. That's the beauty of a polymetallic mine such as this. So 2021 exploration field season, you released your plans. When do you expect to commence drilling?
Yeah, so we're on the ground there right now. We're getting people into the camp. And as you know, COVID is a big issue, and we put in significant COVID protocols. We're going to have testing before people head to the site, and then we'll have rapid testing at the site as well. So one of the keys is really making sure our workforce is safe and that we're very mindful of the impact of COVID. It had a big impact on us last year, Kerry, because we weren't able to have a field season. So what we're trying to do is make up for a little bit of lost ground. So people will be on the ground shortly. They expect to start drilling in June. We expect drill results, just based on what we've done in the past, to start to come out sometime in September. This is probably going to be, if not the largest, one of the largest drill campaigns that we've ever had in the Ambler Mining District. And so we have big expectations associated with this program. And we see it sort of split up into three different areas. We see 7,600 meters being drilled at Arctic, which is about metallurgical drilling, a resource delineation, and really testing the outer boundaries of the Arctic ore body. We see additional drilling in and around the Arctic deposit, so within 3 to 5 kilometers of Arctic and satellite deposits in and around Arctic. And then we see more of a regional exploration drill campaign where we focus on some of the VTEM anomalies that we had identified a couple of years ago. And we're also going to be looking at the bornite area, where we have one hole planned in between Arctic and bornite. And we're looking at a couple of holes adjacent to bornite, and it will be really dependent on just how much time we have in the field campaign. So we've got a lot of work to do this year, but we're very excited about what we're going to try to get done in the field season.
Obviously, the priority is Arctic, but you have an eye towards bornite, because one day, hopefully in the not too distant future, when the Ambler District's producing, bornite is next.
I think you're absolutely right. I mean, when you think about the district as a whole, what's really interesting about our story, Kerry, is that when South32 made its initial investment to come into this project in 2017, they put $30 million on the table for exploration drilling, and it was split between 17, 18, and 19, $10 million each year. All of that drilling was focused on bornite. Their original interest in coming into this project was bornite. It only shifted to Arctic when we put out a pre-feas in 2018 that indicated very robust economics. So people forget about bornite, but bornite was the actual reason why South32 looked at Trilogy to begin with. So bornite's a great asset. And I would say right now we're getting zero value for it in our share price. It's 180 million tons at roughly 1.6% copper. There's lots of upside associated with it. And so we're hoping to create a bit of excitement with respect to bornite this year. Even that one hole in what we call the lowlands will be exciting if we're able to detect mineralization that connects bornite to Arctic.
And let's not forget tens of millions of pounds potentially of cobalt there, which is in scarce supply and high demand.
Yeah, 77 million pounds is the inferred resource at bornite in terms of cobalt. You know, the challenge, of course, will be the separation of that cobalt from in the processing in terms of processing the ore that would be mined at bornite. But that's a problem for another day that we'll be looking at resolving. But yeah, we feel very confident about not just copper at Bornite, but obviously the cobalt resource that's there and the prospects that are in the district.
One of the nice things about Trilogy right now, and just go over to trilogymetals.com, sign up for the notifications. You're trading at or near your 52-week high. It seems like at one point you were down to the 140s. Now it's up to close to 275. It seems like maybe the market's discovered or rediscovered Trilogy all of a sudden. What do you attribute that to?
You know, we had a great year last year, Kerry, and I think a couple of things happened to us. One is we didn't have the field campaign, and that hurt us. And so we didn't have any news out in the fall of 2020. And so people really weren't looking at the story. I think the other thing is that people, when people look at Trilogy, they realize that we don't have copper production today. It's really about proper copper production in the future. And if they want direct copper exposure, they go to some of the existing producers. But they now start to see the disconnect between these values. And they also understand that these producers are going to need to replace their reserves and resources and what they're mining today. And then the other big factor impacting us last year is we had a seller in the market that was looking to liquidate its position because they had redemptions. And that was a bit of an overhang on the share price. And you're right, we traded down to about $1.40, $1.45. I bought 200,000 shares in the market myself when we cleaned up that block that was outstanding. That was in November of last year. And I've just increased my own personal position by 150,000 shares just a week ago, in fact, in terms of exercising options and continuing to hold those shares. So I think there's a lot of upside in this story. I think we're in a really good position in terms of where the story is going, where our prospects are and heading into this field season. You know, the real key to our project is plus 4% copper equivalent. And when you look at other development assets out there, you see 0.5%, 0.4%. So our grade's almost 10, 11, 12 times as high as some of these other deposits that are out there. That's what really makes our project different than most.
And not to mention the fact your partners in the project, South 32, the tribe, Nana, and their corporation, the state of Alaska, everybody is pushing for this project, and it's extremely well capitalized. The last time I looked, you had just on your side of the balance sheet on the ledger, you had $80 million in liquidity. Obviously, you're burning capital, but you're well positioned financed to make this thing happen.
It's a lot of things to cover there. So I'll start with the partnerships, then come back to the balance sheet. There are those major partnerships that you indicated. So 32 is a large Australian company. They were demerged out of BHP a number of years ago. And we're one of the focused assets in their portfolio in the sense that when they look at base metals and copper, we're their asset that they have that they're looking to develop their base metal story on, their copper story on. So they've invested about $200 million in Trilogy in the Ambler Mine District, $30 million in exploration, $145 million to create the JV, which was created at the beginning of 2020. And then they own 11+% of the company itself. So they've already invested $200 million. That sort of shows their commitment to the story. And it's great to have to be there side by side with them because they have a rich mining history. When we look at COVID protocols, for example, we really turned to our South 32 partners and looked at what they were implementing at other operations and put those in place. So they're a great partner. The second partnership is with the state of Alaska through ADA. And ADA is a development agency in the state. And ADA is really the driving force behind the road to access the Ambler Mining District. Without the road, we won't have an Ambler Mining District. Without the Ambler Mining District, we won't have a road. So we need each other. And the model that we're looking at is very much built on another mine that was built in the northwest part of the state, the Red Dog Mine, where they worked with Nana, the Native Corporation, with ADA to build a road and a port to allow that mine to be built. And that road was funded by ADA. And then what happened was Teck and Nana entered into a tolling agreement. We're looking at exactly the same model where we would enter into a tolling agreement with ADA and we would pay for that road over time, not just from Arctic, but Bornite, and then any other mines that are developed in the district. And then the third partnership is with Nana. Nana is a Native corporation that represents 14,000 shareholders / residents of the district. The key with Nana is really about subsistence hunting and fishing and the impact on the traditional additional NANA lands that we have access to as a result of our agreement with NANA. And so we're working very closely with NANA, I would say very much in partnership to advance this project. They have the ability to either take a direct interest in any mines that we developed in the district, or they get a net profit of interest of 15%. So we have a partner that's financially going to benefit from the development of these assets. There's going to be jobs that are going to be created in the district, and there's going to be procurement opportunities as well as taxes that will be paid there. So we think it's a very much a win-win situation, and we're very aligned with NANA, with ADA, and with South 32 and the state of Alaska. So we feel like we're in a very strong position. And then balance sheet wise, sorry to cut you off there, Kerry. Balance sheet wise, you mentioned the financial position that we're in. And as I said, South 32 contributed $145 million to fund the JV. The JV still has most of that cash. There's about $140 million in the JV. And then Trilogy has $10 million in cash. So your $80 million is basically half of that 140. That's 70 plus a 10. That's 80. So that's what puts us in such a strong position and probably a better position than most development companies out there, because we're well funded for the next 4 years.
World-class project with world-class partners and the experience of your team to bring this about, to make it reality. All of it's pretty exciting. The road's continuing apace. I noticed that State of Alaska, their development authority, financed, they budgeted for this year.
There's two aspects to what we've been doing with the road. One is the detailed engineering for the road. So we've entered into agreement with ADA, where Trilogy and ADA would each contribute $35 million over the next three years or so to fund the detailed engineering. So that first contribution is going to happen this year, where we're spending about $14 million, so $7 million funded from each party to fund our share of a detailed engineering. And that's to move the road project forward in a big way. The second thing that ADA is doing is working very closely with the other stakeholders. They entered into a land access agreement with Doyon, which is another native corporation in the state, to access their lands for purposes of advancing the road. They did the same thing with the Bureau of Land Management earlier this year in terms of an agreement on access to BLM lands to allow the road to move forward. They'll be working with the state in terms of doing that as well. So I think all of those steps are advancing, and we feel like we're in a very good position in terms of how the road is moving forward, which is key to getting this project ultimately sanctioned for development.
Yeah, that's the linchpin to the whole thing. It's finally moving forward after decades of discussion. So many big projects, they talk about it and they talk about it. Finally, progress starts to be made, and then all of a sudden it hits a point, critical mass, as we call it, and the project moves forward and things start getting done, and you're at that stage now. It's pretty amazing. So go over to trilogymetals.com, sign up for notifications so you can keep up with the news flow. It's going to be fast and furious now, that's for sure. And don't forget the tickers on the TSX, on the New York, it's TMQ. Tony, sounds like you got your work cut out for you this summer, and we wish you the best. We'll check in with you periodically and see how things are going. Thanks so much.
Kerry, thanks again, and thanks for the support, and thanks to your listeners. And please do visit our website, trilogymetals.com, and the ticker symbol TMQ. Look forward to further updates. Thanks again.
The Financial Survival Network.